If you're like me, you love to buy microphones and other audio stuff. But after years and years of making gear purchases, I have reached the conclusion that not everything is worth the money. So today we're going to talk about this many audio things that I no longer buy and what I do instead. And maybe it will help you save a little bit of money and a lot of disappointment. So in no particular order, the first thing I do not buy anymore are foam pop filters. So with the prevalence of podcasting these days, I'm sure you are familiar with what these things are. They are a gooseneck, round, circular foam filter that is designed to eliminate plosives in front of your microphone. And I don't buy these things for a number of reasons. The first being, it gets in the way. Most of the time, they are so massive and so in your face that for me, I can't see past the microphone, or if I'm shooting something on camera, you can't see my face. I mean, how many video podcasts have you watched where you can't even see the host because they are sitting behind a giant foam pop filter? Second, they don't last forever. In fact, the last pop filter that I had, the foam part disintegrated probably within a year or 2 years. And yes, I probably could have gone out and gotten a pair of pantyhose to put over that circular frame, but at that point, I was just overusing them. Now, technically, you can get away with not even having a pop filter if you have good mic placement. So if your microphone is placed a little off-axis and your air expelled is going not past the capsule, you probably won't even pop your microphone. But I do like having something to protect the capsule from things like errant spit that might accidentally ruin the electronics within your microphone. And while many grills will usually do that, if I do want to have a pop filter for things like up-close miking, I will use something like this. This is a metal windscreen. And if you're interested, I'll drop a link in the description below. But this basically goes over any microphone and sits relatively close to the actual basket of the mic, making it far less obtrusive and a lot more streamlined. In fact, the microphone that I use on a regular basis is the Lewitt LTC 440 Pure. Lewitt's design includes a metal pop filter with a magnetic feature that clips right into the shock mount. And speaking of mics, the next audio thing I will no longer buy are expensive microphones. Now, today, microphones are more accessible than ever before, and we have a litany of different types and styles ranging from under $100 to well over $1,000. And while I have used my fair share of $500, $600, $700, $1,000 plus microphones, I personally try to stay within that $300 price point. You know, there is something called diminishing returns when it comes to audio gear, and that is that more expensive gear doesn't necessarily equate to better sounding audio. Yes, if you buy an inexpensive $25 microphone off of Amazon, chances are a $300 microphone will sound exponentially better than that. But the difference between a $300 to $400 microphone and an $800 to $900 microphone, unless you are an audio professional, the average solo content creator and their audience won't even be able to tell the difference. For me personally, because I rely on my microphones every single day, I like the idea of being able to quickly replace a mic if something happens to it and it won't break my bank. I mean, there's nothing worse than buying a really expensive high-end microphone and then something happening to it and then you have to send it into repair or scrap it. Never mind the fact that some of these higher-end microphones don't even come with accessories, and those accessories that you do need are also really expensive, further perpetuating your need to spend a lot of money. So while I won't spend money on expensive mics anymore, the next thing I won't buy are cheap cables. You know, your audio quality is only as good as your signal chain. And when you have a nice-sounding microphone and a nice-sounding audio interface or a recorder, but you put a cheap cable in between, that could be your weak point. And this holds true for XLR cables, quarter-inch cables, 3.5 millimeter cables. There are a lot of different factors that can cause cheap cables to not sound great, including things like not being shielded properly, having poor soldering connections internally that you can't even see, using inexpensive parts like cheaper connectors that could be prone to breaking, and sometimes these inexpensive cables don't have the lifespan that you would expect them to have. Now, if you are in a studio setup and you are using the same microphone into the same interface and you never disconnect them for any single reason and you never move your gear around and you buy the appropriate length of cable that you actually need, then yeah, this might not be such a big deal. But if you are consistently changing out mics, if you are taking your recording equipment to other locations, if you are outside in the elements. Inexpensive cables can be the culprit of buzzing in your audio or other unwanted interference and noise in your signal chain. Now, personally, for my professional work, I use Canary cables with Neutrik XLR connectors. And while they are on the pricier side, for me, they're worth it. But for the average solo content creator, you might not need to go that expensive, but definitely don't think that you could buy a cheap $5 cable and have that cable last for any significant amount of time. Acoustic foam panels. So when it comes to audio gear that has the biggest, misconception or misunderstanding when it comes to audio and sound quality, are these egg crate foam acoustic panels. Yeah, these guys right here. And I know you've seen these all over the place on YouTube. They're usually like back here as someone's backdrop, or you've seen them in a studio setup. And while they look cool and they look like they have a professional sounding setup, these foam panels do very little when it comes to actually treating your space acoustically. Yes, in theory, they do help with some of the higher frequencies in the spectrum, but not a lot of stuff within the human voice range. When it comes to sound treatment, there are really two big concepts. Those are absorption and diffusion. Absorption is basically absorbing the energy that your voice or sound creates, and diffusion is exactly that, taking that energy and breaking it up and dispersing it amongst, you know, any number of different directions. And these foam panels, they, like, do neither. So for absorption, you pretty much need a lot of mass. And while my studio space is treated with Owens Corning 703 acoustic panels with an air gap between them and the walls, that might not be a realistic solution for people that don't have a dedicated space to record their YouTube videos in. So if you have some money to spend on room treatment, which, by the way, you probably should, instead of getting something like these acoustic panels, I would always recommend you get an audio blanket instead. And I don't mean something like a moving blanket, because those things are much too thin to actually do anything. I am talking about actual sound blankets that are designed to absorb sound. And I personally use sound blankets by Audimute, and even just springing for one of these blankets and placing it in a strategic way can help your audio like tenfold. Headphones. Now, I'm not saying that you shouldn't buy studio headphones. I think you should. But headphones are one of those things that are difficult to find the right ones for you, based on your own personal preferences and your production needs. Never mind the fact that if you are not located near a store that actually has them to demo and you're buying them online, yeah, that can be almost a nearly impossible task. And so for me, I don't like buying the latest and greatest headphones or new headphones at all. I don't like breaking in headphones. And if you didn't know, headphones from the factory typically sound one way, and then after somewhere between 10 to 20 hours of use, they will settle into how they will sound moving forward. Headphones are just one of those things that once I find a pair that I like, I just stick with them. Right now, I currently use these Sony MDR7506s, and I like them for a variety of reasons. They are small and compact and foldable. The ear cups are comfortable to my ears. I like the way they sound, and I appreciate them having a long cable that is both straight and coiled. In fact, I like them so much, yeah, I have two. Lavalier microphones. Now, I know what you're thinking, how can I not like lavalier microphones? They are super convenient, really discreet, and they are a necessity to a lot of content creation needs. And while I do own a number of lavs, they're not something that I personally like buying anymore. Primarily because when I use them in the traditional lav placement, you know, clip right here on your shirt, because I have a lower resonant voice, and because the lavs are omnidirectional with their polar pattern, for me, when I record with lavs, it ends up just being extremely bass heavy because they pick up all of the sound resonating in my chest cavity. And this point really isn't a knock on lav microphones in general, because they could very well work great for your content creation needs and your specific voice. But it's really about having a good understanding of microphones in general, how they work, and which ones might not be best for you specifically. And in my case, lavaliers are those mics that just, don't work well, without a lot of EQ work in post. Which leads me to the next thing that I will no longer buy, and those are expensive audio plugins. Now, as a professional voice actor, I do have some plugins. One of my favorites is the Akon Digital Restoration Suite that I bought like a decade ago. That is a VST plugin that I still use in my DAW, and I might still sometimes use in DaVinci Resolve. But the truth is, if you are creating content for YouTube, you most likely can get away with the built-in audio features in your video editing software. And so if you want to do things like basic EQ or even denoise, oftentimes the baked-in effects in something like DaVinci Resolve will probably be just fine. And side note, for some of my YouTube videos, that might be all that I actually use, if anything at all. Microphones based on YouTubers' reviews. Okay, this is a big one because I have an audio-based channel and I have done videos on microphones and gear in the past. And I'm sure you, just like me, end up being fed a lot of these videos on YouTube and watch a fair amount of them. And while I find these videos extremely helpful with regards to learning the different features of some of the equipment that I potentially am interested in, I do not base my purchasing decisions on the audio quality that I hear in these YouTube videos. First of all, the way that YouTube processes audio is not necessarily a realistic representation of the kind of audio that you could be recording yourself. So after all of the uploading and compression and all of that stuff, the end audio might sound different just by being uploaded to YouTube. Second, every creator has a different voice, and no one sounds exactly the same. So it's hard to tell how something like a microphone will respond to your voice compared to someone else's voice that might be significantly lower than yours, significantly higher than yours. Never mind the fact that you don't even know what kind of environment that they could be recording their videos in compared to the environment that you intend on recording your videos in. In fact, I did a whole video on this as to why a YouTuber's mic might sound different than yours, and you can check it out like right up here. Okay, so now you know the things that I no longer buy, and hopefully they give you some food for thought when it comes to your future gear purchases. Because I definitely know the feeling of being excited to buy a new piece of equipment and then that feeling of disappointment when it doesn't turn out to be exactly how I envisioned it. So thanks for watching, and we'll talk again real soon.